Hello everyone, this is Ramya Kannan from High Rise Food Tech Lab. On behalf of BS Abdul Rahman Crescent University, I welcome you all to the training on microbial biofilms, current research and applications. What we are discussing today is biofilms and the application of this in food industry. I am Ramya and I am the managing partner of High Rise Food Tech Lab. And I'm associated with the food industry for more than 16 years in various sectors, including quality, safety, product development, etc. Are biofilms. Biofilms are nothing but a syntrophic consortium of microorganisms. And these microorganisms together, they stick together or to a surface. They form a slimy extracellular matrix, and these extracellular matrix is nothing but polymeric substances which include polysaccharides, proteins, lipids and DNA. Now the presence of biofilms. Biofilms may form either on a living or on a non-living surface. It is present in natural habitats, industrial areas and even in hospital settings. The microbes which form a biofilm in response to various factors, and this includes the cellular recognition between the microorganism and the attachment sites or the surfaces. So that is one of the factors which trigger a biofilm formation. The second one are the nutritional cues which the microbes get from the surrounding environment. Now what happens is, as the biofilms start growing, there is a shift in the behavior of the cells of the microorganisms. Moving on, just to look at biofilms a little more in depth. Biofilms are hydrogels. By hydrogels, we mean they are a complex polymer, but they contain many times the weight of their weight as water. So biofilms, they are not just bacterial slime layers, but they are an entire biological system. And these biofilms, the bacteria in it forms a well-coordinated functional community, and it can attach to any surface such as a rock or a non-living surface, and at many times it attaches to a single species or a diverse group of microorganisms. Now these biofilms, two important aspects is the biofilm bacteria, they share the nutrients and also they are protected from the harmful factors in the environment such as desiccation, antibiotics or even the host body's immune system. Now these biofilms, how do they start forming? The formation begins when a free swimming bacteria attaches to a surface. Now this is what triggers the formation of the biofilm. The formation of biofilms, it can be divided into five different stages. One is the initial attachment, where a free bacteria attaches itself to a surface. This is what we call as the initial attachment. Then you have, as the word itself says, it's an irreversible. This is the second stage where there is an irreversible attachment. And then the third and fourth stages are the maturation stages, where the biofilm starts maturing and growing. And finally, the final stage is the dispersion. So the biofilm dispersion is a what happens in the fifth or the final stage. Now the hydrophobicity also has an impact on the ability to form biofilms. So if there is an increased hydrophobicity, then there could be a reduced repulsion between the surface and the bacteria. Another aspect for this attachment is that bacteria which attach to a surface, it can be on their own, and in times, in certain cases, if there is limited mobility, they anchor to a matrix or any earlier bacteria which could have been present on the surface. Non-motile bacteria cannot recognize surfaces or aggregate together as easily as motile bacteria. So far what we have seen is about the biofilms in general. Just a quick introduction. What we are going to see now is the effect of these biofilms in the food industry. What are the major microorganisms that contribute to these biofilms, and what are the ways to reduce their activity or remove their activity in the food industry? So in food, if you see, the biofilms, it depends upon the type of species and also what type of food is being manufactured. Basically, the main categories in the food industry, the biofilms belong to either bacteria or the fungi. Now, where do these biofilms attach themselves to? Biofilms, there are two main things, which is one, it attaches to hard surfaces. One, the hard surfaces can include mainly equipment such as pipelines, RO membranes, pasteurizer plates. These are the common surfaces in the food industry. Basically the equipment. It can even attach themselves to storage surfaces. For example, silos for raw materials. Silos are huge storage areas where grains are stored. So these silos for raw materials, it can be storage surfaces where additives are stored, and even other surfaces like tables, and then employee handling, contact surfaces or packing material. So these are the common surfaces to which the biofilms can attach to. The other kind is the biological structures, which includes vegetables, fruits, meat and bones. Okay. Now the structural role of the extracellular matrix, this contributes to the persistence of the biofilms in the food industry. So biofilms, they give the microbial cells an advantage, such as they give them the resistance from physical and mechanical treatment, and also in some cases they give them chemical protection against antimicrobials, against detergents, against disinfectants or sanitizers. So this is the basic role of a. Now, the formation of biofilms in the food industry. Biofilms basically form very, very quickly in food industry environments. So this again, what are the steps in biofilm formation in a food industry? So first is conditioning of the material surface. So the material, that is the surface to which the biofilms are going to attach themselves. So the conditioning of the material surface. Then the reversible binding of the cells to the surface. So it starts off with a reversible binding and then it moves on into an irreversible binding. Now this irreversible binding, it further goes on to the development of microcolonies. The last step in this is the biofilm's tridimensional structure formation, which is a very, very complex ecosystem. So the important aspect here we are looking at is what are the species that contribute to the biofilm formation in the food industry, and if they are in particular the human pathogens, then it has a lot of effect on the safety of the food products. So these pathogens, what happens, they develop biofilm structures on these structures which are very common in the food industry, such as the stainless steel plates or the polyethylene or the rubber. So these are commonly available surfaces in the food industries, and the pathogens, they attach themselves and then also they develop the biofilm structures here. Now the other aspects of importance in this is also that the biofilms can cause corrosion of the metal surfaces, and also it can bring about changes in the organoleptic properties due to secretion of lipases and proteases. So the organoleptic properties we mean by the taste and the smell of the food product. Now this can changes in this can be brought about because of the enzymes and the such as the lipases and the proteases. Okay. The third aspect, which is very, very part of the dairy industry, is related to the raw milk storage or the butter storage and the cheese storage, where these biofilms have an adverse effect. So, moving on, we are going to look at the five major pathogens which will have an effect or which has been associated with the food industry in the biofilm formation. The first of these is a Bacillus cereus. A quick description of Bacillus cereus: as we all know, Bacillus cereus is a toxin producing facultatively anaerobic gram-positive bacteria. And it is found most commonly in the environment, in the soil and in vegetation. And when we look at what are the food matrices that Bacillus cereus can be present in, are mainly cereal products, to a certain extent dairy products, meat products, vegetables, and also in buffet meals. Okay. Now, what the temperature range, again, for all these pathogens, the temperature range at which it grows plays a very critical factor. So the temperature range at which this can multiply is between 4 to 50 degrees, and Bacillus cereus basically causes two types of illnesses. One is diarrheal, nausea, vomiting, etc., and the other, it can also cause infections of the eye, the respiratory tract, and also cause some wounds. So the matrices we saw. Now, how does it affect the biofilm formation and in what industry? Now, for example, the Bacillus cereus, if this is found in the dairy industry, and where is it found? It is found in the air-liquid interface. The biofilm which is present in this air-liquid interface, it is present as a ring which starts protruding into the liquid, and the liquid we are talking about here is the milk. And slowly what happens is there is a migration into the milk by the pathogen, which is easy because of this biofilm's presence. Further on, what happens? There is a production of endospores, and bacteria in this survives even in the industrial pasteurization process. So ideally, in a food industry, around 62 to 65 degrees could be the milk pasteurization temperature. But in the case of presence of biofilms which release the pathogen and further releases endospores, the survival of these endospores can be these endospores will survive and will not be affected by the pasteurization process. So the biofilms from the Bacillus cereus in dairy factories, what happens? They further reduce the shelf life of the milk and also the cream which is manufactured. And research has shown that even levels as small as 103 to 1010 CFU have been associated with outbreaks of this pathogenic disease. The next bacteria, which is very, very common pathogen and also as a bacteria, is the E. coli. And E. coli is a gram-negative, rod-shaped coliform bacterium, which is commonly found in the lower abdomen of endotherms. But there are specific strains of the E. coli which causes food poisoning, the EPEC and the ETEC strains. So these pathogenic strains, how are they transmitted? They are transmitted, primary source of this transmission is the drinking water. Then you have even raw milk, which is a source of this pathogenic bacteria. Then fruits and vegetables, and this can include tomatoes, melons, parsley, whatever. And the last bit, but there are more other sources, but fresh meat is also a source of transmitting the E. coli bacteria. So this is a these are the various sources. So how is this, where, from where does this contamination of E. coli happen? E. coli can happen as early as the in the origin, which is the cultivation stage. So when contaminated water is used for cultivating any of these fruits or vegetables, that can be a source of the contamination or the source wherein the pathogen is spread. Next is the post-harvest technology. Basically, when you have harvested the vegetables and fruits and you are giving it a rinse and the washing is done, then if the water used for washing is not clean, then, and if it is infected with the E. coli, then again that can be a source of contamination. Next is processing of raw materials. This can include vegetables or even meat industry. That can be a source of contamination. Then the food manufacturing process itself, wherein you have to subject the products to a certain temperature to reduce the microbial load or remove the pathogens present. So if inappropriate temperatures are maintained or inappropriate temperatures are used for heating, then again that can be a source of contamination. The last one, after everything is manufactured, if the products are not stored at appropriate temperature, that again can be a source of contamination. So this is in general E. coli, a very, very common pathogen. Sources of this organism is wide, right from drinking water to meat to milk. And there are various sources or various inlets where the contamination or this pathogen can be spread. So what are the factors affecting the E. coli biofilm formation? So when we look at some of the factors, the first factor is the hydrophobicity of the surfaces. So we have various surfaces which are used in the food industry. It can be stainless steel, it can be Teflon, it can be polystyrene or PVC. Now this, what kind of surface and the hydrophobicity of the surface affects the biofilm formation by E. coli. Second point here is the temperature. The lower temperatures increase the biofilm formation. So this becomes a huge risk, especially in the meat industry, where in general the environment or the working temperature in the meat or poultry industry itself, the temperature is maintained at 15 degrees Celsius. So at this temperature, there is a high chance of the biofilm formation on various equipment, on the tables or even the SS, Teflon, etc. Okay. Then the third aspect is presence of other species. So if there are other species which are present, then this increases the survival rate of E. coli. Okay. Then as we all know, E. coli has various serotypes, and this biofilm formation is also based on the serotype. So O157H7 has a higher resistance to temperature and high pressure as compared to other strains. So if this strain is present, there are the chances of biofilm formation from E. coli is high. Then we also have certain strains which exist in the acidic conditions. And in the food industry, there are a lot of aspects wherein the acidic conditions exist. Maybe in the presence of acetic acid, lactic acid and citric acid. And we know that these three acids are very, very common in the industry. Okay, so there are some strains which can exist under acidic conditions. So these are some of the factors which affect the E. coli biofilm formation: hydrophobicity of surfaces, lower temperature, presence of other species of pathogens or microorganisms, the E. coli serotype, which is in specific 0157H7, and the last one is the acidic condition. Okay, so this is about the E. coli film formation. The third pathogen which we are going to look at is the Listeria monocytogenes. Now, Listeria monocytogenes is a gram-positive bacteria. It is quite dangerous. We will see what is the reason for this. And also, as we all know, it's a foodborne pathogen. Why is it dangerous? Because this Listeria monocytogenes it can grow at low temperatures, that is as low as 0 degrees and in the refrigerator temperature. Now, if you see, this becomes a concern because most of the preservation is done at low temperatures. Okay, so seafood, dairy products, meat, ready-to-eat products, soft cheese, ice cream, all these are unpasteurized milk. All these entire range of products are the sources for this Listeria monocytogenes if the product has not been properly treated or manufactured. Okay, now Listeria monocytogenes biofilms, these are mainly composed of something called the tychoic acids, and this grows on polypropylene, steel, rubber or other glass surfaces. The issue with with this pathogen, like I already mentioned, is that it spreads to food batches and it multiplies at refrigeration temperature. So ideally a food product is stored in a refrigerator so that the shelf life is increased. But this is where the Listeria monocytogenes poses a risk to the food. And in terms of what are the factors that affect the biofilms from Listeria monocytogenes, one is its ability to multiply at low temperature, okay, which becomes very critical because of the wide range of products which are stored at low temperature. Second is ability to attach to stainless steel. So stainless steel is one of the widely used metal or material in all the food equipments in a food industry. So this ability of Listeria monocytogenes to attach to SS again poses a big risk. The third one is the increased hydrophilicity or the attraction to water, again by Listeria. Then it also has a resistance to temperature up to 60 degrees Celsius. Okay, so we need to ensure if any treatment is done, the temperature has to be above 60 degrees Celsius. The fifth point is its resistance to pH. And the final point is Listeria also has a resistance to cleaning procedures where quaternary ammonium compounds are used. So these are some of the factors which we need to consider, because Listeria monocytogenes, as you see, has a lot of resistance to various factors. So we need to consider these when we look at the biofilms which are formed because of this pathogen. Moving on, the very, very important pathogen in the food industry, Salmonella enterica. Salmonella enterica is a rod-shaped bacteria, gram-negative. It's a flagellate and it's a facultative aerobe. And where are the sources? Primarily, eggs, poultry are one of the main sources of this pathogen. Then you have other processed foods like mayonnaise, cakes, etc. And the advantage of this is pasteurization and food irradiation are used to destroy the Salmonella pathogens. Refrigeration, as we know, and freezing do not kill the bacteria, but it can slow or stop the growth of this of Salmonella. The biofilm formation based on Salmonella, it again has the ability to grow on SS surfaces, and it also it has an ability to grow under very, very dry conditions. So this again forms a big risk to the food industry. S. enterica can survive in a biofilm on SS for over a year, and this can lead to contamination of food batches. Okay, so this becomes very, very critical. Now, another thing is this, that salmonella gets easily attached to various food matrices. Okay, and then again, like we mentioned, egg and poultry products. So refrigerated poultry products in shelves, etc., manufacturing industry where chicken is pre-cooked. These are some of the areas where biofilm formation because of salmonella is predominant. Okay. Moving on to the last pathogen which we will be looking at is the Staphylococcus aureus. So, Staph aureus is a gram-positive, non-spore forming and a non-motile bacteria. Okay, it is a human pathogen. It produces enterotoxins which are heat stable. The temperature range is between 10 to 46 degrees. And the thing with the Staph aureus is it multiplies on membranes, skin of food handlers, etc. So it's very, very important that the hygiene of the food handlers is maintained to prevent the Staphylococcus aureus from being spread. Okay. The incubation period of this bacteria is between 1 to 6 hours, and the food matrices to which Staph aureus can attach to, it can even attach to products which have a very low water activity. Some things which have high sugar or salt content are very, very suitable for this pathogen. The Staph aureus biofilms, it can be formed at suboptimal temperatures, and then improper disinfection can lead to the biofilms formation. If you have a combination of salt and glucose, this again can have an effect on the biofilm formation, which will be increased in the presence of salt and glucose. And genes involved in the biosynthesis of extracellular polysaccharides also aids in the biofilm formation. So this is a quick understanding of the various pathogens related to the food industry and the effect they have, or the factors that affect the biofilm formation. Okay, now having seen the factors and the pathogens which help in the formation of these biofilms in the food industry, we need to understand what are the methods to control the biofilms in the food industry. So the traditional method of all is the chemical treatments, but then of late you have a lot of other treatments such as enzymatic disruptions, steel coatings, biosurfactants, bacteriocins, bacteriophages, quorum sensing inhibition, and also essential oils. So these are some of the methods which are used to control biofilms formation in the food industry. Of the most common is the chemical treatment. Okay, chemical treatment is something which is widely used in all the food industry. One, it is effective. Two, it is also comparatively cost effective as compared to other treatments. Okay, so the reduction, what is sanitation or what is a chemical treatment? Now we know more about this word of sanitation and disinfection, which has become a very, very common word in today's scenario. But this has been in practice in the food industry for a very, very long time. So the reduction of the microbial load to an acceptable level is a sanitation. So what are the sanitizers? So the commonly used sanitizers in the food industry is the chlorine based sanitizers. So basically the aqueous chlorine dioxide is what is widely used in the industry. Apart from that, you also have NaOCl, which is used to remove biofilms on SS and polypropylene surfaces, especially in the dairy industry. Now these are chlorine based sanitizers. The other type of sanitizer is the chemical treatment which is used for removing the biofilms in food industry is hydrogen peroxide, which is an oxidizing disinfectant. Now this generates free radicals which can come in contact with the biofilm structures, and then they destroy it even at low concentration. So H2O2 is also been known to have a good effect of destruction on biofilms. Ozone gas again destroys biofilms or even viruses, etc., by breaking down their cellular envelope. O3 also helps to prevent mold growth on stainless steel structures in the dairy industries. You also have other quaternary ammonium compounds such as metaquats, which are used as for chemical treatments. This is used as a sanitizer in the food industry to remove biofilms. So how does these work? These are positively charged, they are water soluble, and they disrupt the bacterial cell membrane and causing it to lyse. So this is also an effective way of treatment of biofilms. Okay, now chemical treatments, like I said, is what is common in the industry. The other one, which is what we're going to discuss now, are a lot of research is happening in these fields, and also to a certain extent it is being used in the industry. So the enzymatic disruptions. So this is known more for its green countermeasure, because you know, a lot of industries and a lot of people also are moving away from chemical disinfectants. So enzymatic disruptions are used because they are biodegradable and because of the low toxicity. So proteins and polysaccharides are the ones which form the major components of the biofilm. Hence, to remove that, what happens is the enzymes, that is proteases, okay, such as serine protease, proteinase K, pepsin, trypsin, and are used to remove or break down the protein molecules. Similarly, to break down the polysaccharides, glycosidases, amylases, dextrinase, and pectinase, the common ones. These are used. And if you see, for example, pectin methyl esterase, which is an enzyme, PME. Now, this reduces the biofilm formation in bioreactors, and it is used as a pre-treatment in machines and pipes. Okay, so these are some of the, apart from that, you also have amylases and cellulases, etc., which you use along with industrial detergents to remove the biofilms. Okay, so this enzymes, first, basically they are used because of the low toxicity, and they have they break down the biofilms because of the structure of the biofilms. The other thing is, some of these enzymes are used in combination with chemical disinfectants to remove the biofilms. On we have something called the steel coatings. Now this is also another method, alternative method for chemical disinfection by use of nanotechnology agents. Here what happens is, you have some of the unique properties of nanoparticles, that is NPs, which distinguish them from their chemical counterparts. So NPs or nanoparticles are less prone to induce bacterial resistance than traditional antibiotics. A lot of research is happening on this aspect, but some of the components here are the carbon-based materials, the fullerenes and carbon nanotubes, dendrimers, nanocomposites, natural NPs. Then you have metal-based NPs, which including silver, gold, and metal oxides. Now these nanoparticles are used on the steel as a coating, and this further reduces the bacterial growth or the biofilm formation. It is still a very, very niche area, which has been a lot of research is happening in this field, and limited use in the food industry. But I'm sure this is going to pick up in a big way. Then the biosurfactants. You have biosurfactants. So biosurfactants are natural compounds, and usually they have a microbial origin. They have the ability to modify the characteristics of the bacterial surface. Okay, so these biosurfactants alter the adhesion or the binding capacity of the bacteria. Therefore, they are used in the food industry. Now, the food industry surfaces can be treated with this biosurfactant, and this diminishes the binding of the microbes onto the surfaces. Okay, and the molecules, what happens is, they insert themselves into the microbial cell membrane, and this alters the membrane permeability and also disrupts it, and then causes the cell death, and by causing cell swelling, it causes a death. Okay. Then we move on to bacteriophages. Again, antimicrobial activity carried out by bacteriophages, and these due to their specific killing of the cells. Okay, so as a result of this, the phage therapy is currently an alternative also to antibiotics. Okay, again, a lot of research is being done, but also commercialization of this is underway. Okay, but it looks promising. Last but one is about the bacteriocins. So bacteriocins is these are used in the food industry to prevent the biofilm formation on different surfaces. The antimicrobial agents which can extend the expiration date of a food as well. Okay, and they alter how do they do that? They protect the food, they all bring about alterations during the refrigeration, which lowers the food spoilage. It also prevents the transmission of foodborne pathogens and diminishes chemical preservative usage, and also reduces the amount of temperature treatment. So this is the way the bacteriocins are used in the food industry. Last one is the essential oil, which is very, very common. Plant-derived components demonstrate anti-biofilm properties. So the essential oils also demonstrate and destruction against the biofilm formation. Now this is has a much more positive perception by the consumer and by the industry as compared to the synthetic disinfectants. Okay. So what are the plant-based essential oils which have been found to be effective against the biofilm formation? One is a mixture of monoterpenoids. Now this can include borneol, camphor, eucalyptol, nemonine, pinene, etc. Then you have sesquiterpenoids, which are caryophyllene and humulene. The last one is the flavonoids, which is the cinnamonaldehyde and the phenolic acids. So these are all plant-based essential oils, and they are used as a combination or as a separate, as single thing. But the thing is, the positive thing is because it is a natural antibiofilm. It has natural antibiofilm properties as compared to the chemical disinfectants. So coming to the conclusion, food industry biofilms, this actually poses a serious economic and a health issue. And the existence of biofilms in various surfaces in the food industry, in the long run, it does lead to a lot of financial losses also, apart from health issues, also in terms of corrosion, etc. So the health effects due to the presence of pathogens, which include bacillus and staphylococcus, which cause intoxications, or gastroenteric problems, which are caused by E. coli and salmonella, or systemic diseases, again by E. coli and listeria. The health effects because of these pathogens are very, very enormous, and it's also very critical to the food industry. So you do have traditional methods in the food companies which are being used, such as chemical disinfectants, and also physical methods, hot water, steam, ozone, etc. In spite of that, a lot of research is happening on food biofilms and also their effective control. And this research and development, or the R&D, includes use of bacteriocins, nanoparticles, essential oils and enzymes. So we still have a long way to go in terms of implementing these various other methods of controlling biofilms in the food industry. We have a long way to go, but I'm sure in the long run, this will be commercialized and will be put into use in the industry. So this is a quick look at the references I have used for the presentation, and like to thank School of Life Sciences, B.S. Abdul Rahman Crescent University, for giving me this opportunity to talk on biofilms. It was a good learning for me also, because this is something which is a problem in the food industry, and there are various aspects and a lot of research is being done in this field, I'm sure it will be put to good use. So thank you, and I wish and hope all of you stay safe. Thank you.